Hello? Okay. Hi, everyone. It's week two, so it's week three. Okay, it's week three, so today is going to be basically about, we're going to learn some more Python, and we're also going to do pitches. So I hope you guys are super excited for pitches. We actually ended up getting quite a few, so that's really exciting. If you still have like a really good idea or like maybe just like an average idea and you want to come up and pitch, we can do last minute ones too. So after everybody goes, you can come up and share your idea as well. You don't need like a name or anything. You can figure that out later. So, yeah. Okay, so first we're going to take attendance. So if you go to Relate, you should be able to find the quiz. And it kind of just reviews topics we talked about last week. So we can go ahead and do that with you. We're having some technical difficulties. It'll be up in a second. Or 5 minutes. Yeah, let's do it. Okay, Okay, so we'll take attendance in a minute. But other announcements, so we'll have office hours this week. If you're having trouble with the homework or you have any other questions, please come to office hours. Even if you have questions about your projects or something at this point, you can come to office hours. And so besides that, we're going to have pitches and we're going to be doing team formation this week. So we'll be putting you with your PM and with your other group members, and we'll be sending out a form so you guys can give your preferences. You don't have to be put in a random group that you're going to hate. Usually people get matched up with groups that they like, so that should be coming out soon. And then on Saturday during the hackathon, we'll actually like give you reveal like your PM and your group and what project you're going to be working on. So you want to make sure you show up to that. If you can't show up to that, please email us so we know that you won't be there. But we can get you up to speed on what you missed. Okay, so attendance should be working now. If you go to Relate, Okay, so you guys are probably, you guys are probably done with the quiz. If you just like walked in late, basically just do the quiz and relate for attendance. Okay, back to the lecture slides. Okay, so homework two is gonna be released tonight, so you can go ahead and get started on that. It's gonna be due next Tuesday, so yeah, the earlier you start, the better. Probably will be pretty simple this week, but remember that you can come in for office hours if you need help. Yep, and this is when office hours are, and they're going to be in 11:05, and you can check the calendar to see who's going to be there if you care for some reason. Okay, so now we're going to start our next Python section. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about lists and, lists, strings, arrays, and loops. So so basically, you can see this up here on the screen, but I'm still going to ask you, what kind of functionality are we looking for with a list? Like, what kinds of things do we need to do? Yeah, okay. What kind of operations would we want to do on a list? Someone from that side. Yes, you back there. Right, yeah, okay. So what do we need to be able to access to be able to do that? Yeah, exactly, right? So that's one of the things we have here is length. So when we iterate through lists, we definitely need the length, right? Because we don't want to go past it. We need to get every element, right? Another thing, we want to be able to insert things, right? So we don't want to just have a list and that's it, right? It just sits there. We want to be able to actually put things in the list and put them in specific positions, right? And then what's the difference between inserting and appending? Yeah.
Inserting can go in any index you want, appending automatically ends to the end of the list.
Right, exactly. Okay, so here we have a list. Just 1, 2, 3, 4, pretty simple. In Python, we use square brackets to denote a list. And so we have a list of integers here, and then here we have a list with an int and a string. So you can see both of those. Here's another list with four elements. Oh, hold on a sec. Okay, so how you access a specific element in the list is you basically use the square brackets and you give it the index of the element. So you guys probably just saw this, but what do you think A of 0 is going to print? Or is what do you think the output of that is? Exactly, right? Because that's the first index. What about if I change it to 3? What about now? Right, okay. So that's pretty simple stuff, right? Okay, how about if we append the number 14, and then we do an insert? First of all, we mentioned this before, but appending puts a number or puts the element at the end of the list, right? So 14 should go to the end of the list. What about insert though? Can somebody explain to me what's going on with that line? Somebody back there on the left side. You sitting on the end in the blue shirt. Who's looking back, but I'm looking at you. See you. Yeah, you.
You're putting the value 9 in the view.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So basically, what should the length be now, right? So we appended an element and we inserted an element, right? To begin with, the length was 4, right? So now what do you think it's gonna be? You can just shout it out.
Exactly what you think it is.
It's not trick.
5?
Okay, it's 6, right?
Oh wait, yeah, sorry.
That's okay. Yeah, so it's 6 basically. And then what do you think our list is gonna look like now? So can somebody just give me the string of numbers? What does it look like now? So remember we inserted 9 and we appended 14.
9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
Okay, let's see. And you're right, so yeah. It's all really, really simple stuff, right? But these are like really useful things, really basic useful things that we need to know how to do. Okay, so next we're gonna talk about strings, because strings are kind of like a special kind of list. They have a lot of the same operations you can do on a list, you can also do on a string, which is super useful. So let's say we have our string hello, right? What are we gonna get when we index the first, the zeroth element of hello? Anybody? Yeah, right? So that's pretty simple. And then what do you think we're gonna get for the length? Someone in the first row over there. It's really awkward when I just wait, but I will wait. Right, okay. All right, so basically there's a lot of other things we can do with strings. It'd be kind of boring if we just had strings and that was it, and we couldn't do anything with them, right? So one thing we can do is we can concatenate them, which is basically putting them together. So when we concatenate hello and world, we get hello world, right? And we just do that with the plus operator. So that's all really, really simple stuff, right? We can also store strings in variables, right? So like we learned last week, Python doesn't make you declare a type when you make your variables. So basically you can just say something like b is equal to a string and that's fine. So we have b is equal to world. If you don't remember, a was hello. So when we do a plus b, we get hello world, right? Okay. Now we're gonna talk about something that's a little bit more tricky, right? So I have my variable a and it's set equal to 11, right, an integer. So what do you think is going to happen when I run this line? Someone in the second row on this side. Okay, so you don't think it's a problem that it's an integer? What do you think this function does? Yeah, you back there.
It casts the integer of the string.
Yeah, right. So we can actually concatenate it. And so when we run this, we get hello, wait, excuse me, I didn't write this part first. Should not get that. We get 11 world, right? Okay, so pretty straightforward stuff. Similar thing here, when we have 10 and we make it into a string, we're just gonna get 10 as a string instead of an integer. So it's all very straightforward. Okay, now moving into basically just like a comprehensive example of everything we've just talked about. Can somebody explain to me what this does? I think the function name gives it away, but just somebody tell me what it does. You kid in the striped shirt back there. Don't know? Okay. Anybody? It's really simple. I'm giving you like a huge clue. Yes. Yeah, exactly, right? So the way this works is we have our list, right? And then we have, so we start with sum equal to 0, and then we index through the list starting at 0. We go through all the elements and we keep adding them to sum, right? So at the end, we just get a list summed up, right? Pretty simple stuff. Does anybody think this looks a little inefficient, though? Probably a little bit inefficient, which is going to bring us to our next topic. But basically, when we run this, we get 15, right? Which is the sum of all the elements in the list. Okay, so does anybody have any questions so far on strings or lists or anything like that? They can be really stupid questions, I don't care. But you guys have probably covered this in 125, so I'm assuming most of you know this pretty well at this point. All right. Okay, so we're gonna move on to loops. Basically, can someone explain like how could we have used a loop to make this more efficient?
Iterator at I and then do like plus equals for each element in the array and do like a total.
Yeah, you could have just iterated, you could have just had, yeah, a variable that increments a for loop and you could have just gone through and actually added each one up, right? Pretty simple stuff. So that's what we're gonna see here. So in Python, there's a couple different ways to iterate through things, to do loops. So this way, we're gonna go through a range, right? So what do you think the last number is printed here? Nine? Yeah, and it's nine, right? So do you understand it starts here, but it goes up to the last element when you use range. So you're gonna get 0 through 9. Okay. Okay, so what do you think this one's gonna print? Anybody have any idea why this one is different from the earlier one? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So basically, when we run this, we get 0 through 10, right? And so the difference here is that this one iterates through each index in the list and then does something. So in this case, we're printing it, right? And in this case, this example is a little bit confusing because you can use, so num is 0, 1, 2, 3, like it goes through the whole thing, right? But you could also use that as an index for like a list or something. Like you can use that number and it's gonna iterate through that range, correct? With this example, what you're saying is you're looking at each thing within the list. So you're not looking at the index, you're looking at each individual element. So that's why here it goes through and it prints out each thing in the list, right? We didn't use range. We just said for each element in my list, go ahead and print that. So does anybody have any questions about that and the difference between those? Because sometimes you might find that you write a list like this, you write a loop like this, and then you realize like you needed a variable, like you need to know where you are, like like a counting variable. And in that case, something like this would be better because you know where you are in the loop. You know which iteration you're on. Whereas here, it's just gonna go through each thing. Okay. Okay, so now basically we're gonna do an example of summing an array. So let's go ahead and let's come up with a list. I'm just gonna copy one of these. Okay, so somebody give me, a variable name. What should we name our array?
I?
Okay, that's fine. Simple. Okay. And then what do we want to put in this list? So it can be anything. I'm really hungry right now, so I'm gonna put types of food. So let's do, yeah. Okay, types of food. Somebody give me a type of food. Anything. Good. Okay, another thing?
Lettuce,
okay. All right, we need two more.
Onion.
Okay.
Pineapple.
Damn, it's not really healthy. Okay. All right, okay, so we've got our list We've got our food. Okay, so basically, what we're gonna do is we're gonna write a loop that goes through and sums the values here, and then we'll do something with the food array too. Okay, so, does somebody wanna tell me the syntax for, actually, we'll do two lists here. So first we're gonna write it this way, using this kind of syntax, and then we'll do it this way. So what I want my first loop to do is sum the numbers in this array. So can somebody just tell me the syntax for how to do that? What should I type? It's okay if you're wrong, we can fix it, yeah.
For j in range len of I.
Okay.
First you need to declare sum is equal to 0, then sum plus equal to I, j.
Okay, yeah, so we need a sum variable, right? And then we need a sum variable for that.
But you need to like define it before the loop.
Okay, and does everybody understand why we use length of I there, right? Okay, good. Okay, now what? Somebody else. Okay. You with the pink water bottle. You. I'm looking right at you. Yes. What do you think we should type down? Remember that we're trying to just sum up all the numbers.
Sum up I.
Sum all the numbers in the list.
Mm-hmm. And to make it a little bit more interesting, so you don't get confused with the other example, I'm not going to put them in order.
Sum equals to plus. Sum plus equal to. I, J,
okay. Yeah, so that looks pretty good, right? And then let's go ahead and let's make sure that works. So let's print sum. And you guys do the math, what should it be? I need to actually go. Okay, yeah, and so the sum is 14, right? So that was perfect. You guys did a really good job. And now for our second loop, we're gonna do the other way. So for this one, I wanna go through and I wanna print out each type of food in my array, right? So can somebody tell me, how do I do this using this kind of method? Okay, so, yeah, back there. Right. Okay, good job. So that's super simple, right? And so this is kind of two examples. So for the first one kind of makes sense, right? Because we're using J to index the array, and each of the numbers in the array, we want to add them, right? So basically, accessing each element with the index makes sense for this type of loop, right? And then for this type of loop where we have strings, right, and all I want to do is print them, it makes sense just to go element by element, right? And so, yeah, here we go. Okay, yeah, so you guys did a really good job. It seems like you have a really good understanding of this. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah.
So for the first one, the sum one, so you put only length I there?
Yes.
Right? But in the previous example, like, the previous two numbers,
mm-hmm.
You put like zero, like comma or something.
Right, yeah.
Why?
Okay. So when you do this, Yeah. So you could also do this, and that would work as well.
The same.
Yeah, I think
if you take this out, it'll work too. So you don't actually need that. It'll just assume you're starting at the beginning. Okay? Any other questions? Okay, so your homework is going to be based on this. So should be pretty easy if you understand it. So if you guys don't have any other questions, we're going to go on to pitching.
All right, so now we're going to move on to project pitching. So pretty much the goal of when you come down to pitch a project is going to be to recruit as many teammates as you can on your project and to get people to work with you. So you'll all get up to 5 minutes, but I presume you all won't take that long. And someone on core staff in the front row will give you a signal when you're just 1 minute away from the limit. And pretty much what will happen is after class today, we'll send out a form that lets you pick or rank your preferences for the project that you want to work on, the one that you like the most. And then you'll be matched with a PM, and you'll get a list of your teammates who you'll meet at the hackathon on Saturday. And of course, I think we went over this last week, but the hackathon is this Saturday in Siebel 2405 from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And there will be food, so come for the food if you don't want to come for the class. Food is at 12, yes. All right, so slides. So the first pitch, the kid who sent me these slides, he said he couldn't make it to class. So I'm going to pitch on his behalf. Just so you guys know, I guess, kind of how to go about doing your pitch. So pretty much his website, or I guess app, is going to be a database of drinks. And we've had a famous project that did something similar in previous years, CSM96. I'm sure core staff know about this, but pretty much. Yeah. So these are some pretty good slides because he's asking direct questions. He's saying you want to find a drink, but you don't know where to go or like where you can get the best version of that drink, whatever. So he wants to build out a database that has the locations and also the drinks with reviews, or in this case, a thumbs up or a thumbs down, based on the quality of the drink that is at that location. And then you can put that on a map and then have people look at the ones that are high quality but also closest to them. So that's kind of like the core value proposition of this app. This is a slide with a lot of text, but you guys kind of get the point. Pretty much, I'm not gonna go through his whole story, but it's pretty comprehensive. He says you'll list a whole bunch of drinks, and then you can have people you'll have it display ratings for all of those, and then it'll also show how far away they are from you, so you can then find the one that's closest, but also and the best. And then he also wants to expand it beyond coffee and serve college kids better, so alcohol apparently. So this is a little bit about the technical part of it. So right now, because I feel like they don't have a good data source for this, they want to do data that's mainly created for this, and then in the future he can have businesses also put in their own information to make it easier And then, oh, I guess he has, he's thinking pretty long, but he can also scrape stuff from websites. So the good part about this is that he's focused on goals that are achievable, but also thought about things that you could do to make it better in the future. So kind of a good way to think about breaking down your project into chunks. All right, cool. So, and this is, by the way, this is a real project. Okay, so if you want to work on this, please list this in the project preference form. Because whoever this kid is, it'll be pretty sad if no one picks it. Because I did a bad job pitching it. But yeah. All right. Next up, we have Alvis. Are you here? Yeah.
Hello, I'm Alvis, and I'm pitching about the high-frequency trading. High-frequency trading simply implies the high turnover rate of capital by using automatic trading platforms. We use computer software and data analysis to find the trends and basically make use of the difference between the price of the bid, which means the buy price, and the ask, which means the sell price. Let's take a simple example. For example, let's take bananas as an example. Let's assume this platform is a banana exchange. And you want to buy a banana for $2, and you want to sell it for maybe $1.99. So I know the information before you do. So I could buy the banana from him and sell it to you at the same time. So the margin would be 1 cent. 1 cent seems very small, but if you want to buy maybe a million bananas and you want to sell a million bananas, so the profit would be $10,000, which is pretty decent for a several second trade. And this is the example of the difference between bid price and ask price. And now I listed five pretty common strategies for current high frequency trading. The first one, statistical arbitrage, is to use a statistical method to see which stock is performing better, and to see which one is going up or going down. The second one I found is pretty interesting, so I put an arrow in it, is to use the price difference between the options market and the stock market, because as we all know, the options market is often at like after the stock prices changes. So for example, if we have some, let's say Amazon, if Amazon's stock price is higher than its options market, we could buy a call from the option market and sell the Amazon stock at the same time, and vice versa. The news space hedge fund trading system is like when the news come out, either good or bad, the prices are affected. For example, today, SpaceX launched its very powerful rocket in the afternoon. So I would say that would definitely be a buy signal. And if our computer could do that, we could act on the news immediately, automatically. The momentum ignition means aims to cause a spike in the price, which means actually to manipulate the market price. But I shouldn't use manipulation because it is actually legal and hasn't been banned. The last one is pair trading. Pair trading refers to two stocks in the same field that their price are often in the same trend. For example, maybe a Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola. If you see the trend of one stock, and you could use it on the other one. And based on these common strategies, we will come up with our own algorithm, which is more complex and works better. The two main factors in algorithm trading is the speed and the risk. Many individuals and companies use larger computers. They use faster wire connections, and they even have offices closer to the stock exchange. We don't have access to all that, but we could like improve our algorithm and improve our price margin, and rather than just finding the price difference between the stocks or maybe the options market. And another thing is the risk. As the saying goes, what can goes up can also comes down. As we see last Friday and yesterday, stocks become pretty volatile. So our algorithm has to handle all kinds of situations to reduce our risk to lose money and make profit in the bullish or bearish market. So that's my pitch, and I'm glad to work with you, whoever is interested. Thank you.
I don't really prepare speech, but I'll just kind of wing it. So my name is Peter Weiss. I'm a junior studying statistics. And I guess a couple months ago, I got really interested in cryptocurrencies and trading them. So I figure with cryptocurrencies, I've been thinking about trading stocks, but because, like I think Alvis described, there's a lot of low latency firms doing this really quickly. It's very difficult to do a lot of like arbitrage between options and stocks because of how quickly firms are just taking that opportunity. On the other hand, with cryptocurrencies, there aren't a bunch of big institutions doing that yet. So as of right now, there's more opportunity for individuals like us to pursue algorithmic trading strategies. So I guess I'll just get into it a little bit. If you guys want to trade and not, well, like use algorithms or not use algorithms, you could use things like Coinbase or Gemini to trade big currencies like Bitcoin or Ethereum or LTC for fiat, which is like euro, pound, dollar, anything backed by government. And then use Binance, which is a more technical exchange. It's run by a Chinese company, but that's where basically every kind of like altcoin trades. And I think that's where the profits are be able to be made. And with things like Binance and Coinbase and Gemini, they have open source APIs, so we can grab the API from the exchange and execute on it. So I think it shouldn't be too hard. I mean, obviously, I'm pretty new to computer science, but I know a lot of people are doing this, so I don't think it's too hard. We go to the next slide. So I was thinking of starting by just looking at like technical indicators. Things like RSI, which is an indicator that says overbought or underbought. So like if a bunch of people are buying a stock and there's a lot of like volatility in buys, then RSI starts to peak and hits levels of like 70. And then when people are selling it and they're just getting oversold, it can dip below like 30. So basically, just an easy algorithm that would be, which shouldn't be too hard to implement to start, would be buying when RSI is low, selling when it's high, buying when it's low, anytime it crosses those kind of thresholds. Another thing is MACD, looking at moving averages. So like you see this green and red line, those are exponential moving averages, like a moving average of the past 12 to 26 bars. So when those cross over, you generally see a lot of bearish action when the slower moving average crosses the longer one, and then when the cross happens again, there's more bullish action. So it's another way to trade. And last would be to look at volume. Like when we see big volume spikes, it usually means we're gonna get like some other kind of movement, so you could look at volume too. Last thing, so with TradingView, you can like execute paper trading, and they have like a PyNetter, which sort of runs, I think it runs in Python, but you can basically type in your algorithm and then just execute it in paper trading. So if we did that, we could use TradingView to input our whatever algorithm we want and then test strategies based on that, so it shouldn't be too hard. And then thinking we'd get some results and then probably just do a lot of analysis. Like, I know for my statistics courses, we just take large data sets and run whatever kind of models we want on them. So we could do that and analyze statistical significance of whatever model we use. And other ideas, do some kind of screening for looking at market cap. So market cap is the number of coins times the price. So you could do a screen looking at how a certain like altcoin has jumped in market cap from a certain day to another day and kind of decide like, hey, based on how quickly it ascended in market cap, is this likely to be a good buy? And you could run historical data, so it doesn't necessarily have to be as real time. Arbitrage too, like you could arbitrage the price of a coin in a South Korean exchange and go to a Chinese exchange. There's a ton of people are doing that. I just saw a Wall Street Journal article about a guy who dropped out of college and made a ton of money just arbitraging coins between exchanges. And just monitoring volume spikes, looking at different indicators to just trade on them. So if anyone's interested, love to work with you. So yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, Sandhya, music notes? Alright.
Okay, I'm Sandhya, I'm a freshman, I study physics. My project is about making like a really basic music notation software hosted on the web. If any of you guys know about like MuseScore or something along the lines of that, but then it would have the capability to be shared and edited by multiple people at the same time. That's about it. Know anything
like
about
it.
The stock market. Okay. I'd love to work with you guys.
Okay, is there Stacy here? There's actually two people who put this as their project name, so are either of you people here? Okay, hold on for now. Okay, Bradley Fishman with Attendance System.
So my idea is just pretty simple. I think there's a need out there for a pretty simple UI-based attendance system. A lot of times like RSOs use Google Sheets or other stuff like that, so I think this would be kind of a cool project to make a web-based user interface or an app. You could scan QR codes to check people in, various functionality. Pretty simple.
Jenny?
Okay, hi guys, my name is Jenny, and the project I was pitching was that, so if you have a water bottle, then you want to know, for example, like you want to remind yourself to drink water, so then you'd have like a water sensor, like or like a sensor on the side that you can literally hook onto any bottle, saying like, oh, you still haven't, like, the water level hasn't changed. You haven't drank water for, like, a day. Then it's notifying you that you should drink water. But then also in another way, which is you can, like, hook it onto, like, for example, like, your detergent, your laundry detergent, your, like, hand soap, or, like, I don't know, your shampoo. And then you can say, like, you want to make purchases. Like, for example, when it's really low, you want to make purchases online so you don't want to have to, like, it's kind of like the Amazon dash button, except you're not pushing it, and it just senses it by itself.
So yeah, it's fun. Yeah. Chen with exploring genome sequences.
So real quick, so basically my project is sort of on the bioinformatics side. So if you're interested into biology, like biochemistry and molecular and cell biology, and you do have to take at least like a one level biology course, like MCB 150 or IB 150 or like whatever, just one level, to be able to understand the knowledge for the biology side. But I actually haven't come up with what are we gonna be doing, because there's are a lot of options. So I wanna see like how many people wanna join me, and together we want to brainstorm based on like the skill set, skill level of like each members who are in biology. It could be like exploring the shotgun sequencing, compare the gene cluster between two organisms in a microbiome, like in gut, or we can look at the between chimpanzee and human, and what genes are different and what make us human, you know, those kind of fun things. So really I want to, you know, if anybody want to join me in pitching for Saturday, we can just brainstorm, come up with ideas, and but it's going to be about bioinformatics.
Okay, Andrew with Daily Outfitters.
Yeah, so my idea, I just want to build like an app that's a game. I don't know what game yet, but this is something in entertainment. Hopefully it'll be an addicting game.
I like it.
Thank you.
Okay, James with Galaxion.
I'll explain when I get there.
All right, so first of all, who are sort of like Zork, like text-based adventure games, that kind of thing? We got a few, cool. All right, so the idea of the title Galaxion was like, I just was like inspired by, you know, kind of sci-fi names, so I just came up with, hey, that sounds cool, and sci-fi and 80s, let's go with that. But anyway, my idea is like, you know, so the basic idea behind Zork is like you're dropped in a random space. You have to like, you have to explore, find different secrets in it, and like, you know, progress somewhat, like, you know, there can be a sense of progression, or you could just find out more about the area you're in. Like, modern examples would be like a game like Firewatch, if anyone's played that. But, you know, it's interesting in that it's entirely text-based. Like, you type in a command and your character does that, but it's done in words. So, I think it could be really interesting if some people who really just thought, you know, oh, hey, this is a... like, you know, I could contribute to the story in a meaningful way, or I could do this, and, you know, we can scale it based on how many people are interested or what anyone wants to do. So, yeah. To be honest, the drink app sounded pretty cool, so maybe I'll do that. But if there's enough interest in this, I'll definitely stick with it. So, yeah, let me know what you think, and like I purposely left it vague so that we can fill it in as a team. So, yeah.
Okay, so that's all of the pitches we have scheduled, but if anybody has thought of an idea, you know, like if you're just sitting there thinking like, hey, I'd really like to pitch an idea, you can see it's pretty informal, so go ahead and pitch if you want to. Anybody? Wait, I heard something back there. We'll release the form later, so you'll be able to see. Okay, and now we're going to do staff pitches. So some staff... Well, we'll create the form and we'll put your project name there, and then... Oh, no. Okay, if you want to pitch now, you don't have to fill in the form. You can just come up here. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Sorry, you might have already answered it, but how many people can be in each team?
We're going to determine that. It's probably going to be 4 to 5 right now.
Okay, there's a lot of people in here, so that's everything.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes.
Maybe I want to pitch.
Okay, you should do it.
But I have a little consideration that is Python good at editing music?
Okay, I've seen the project that's kind of like automatic DJ switching music project. So you pick a music and you play a library of music. And when the pitches and the frequency fit, it will automatically switch to another music. So in general, it's pretty cool. And maybe we can try it in party or... Is it working? I don't know. Maybe we can try it in party war or something like that. Because the professor said in the class that the music sounds are like arrays, maybe multidimensional arrays that we just learned so far. But we can try it out. But I'm not really sure it will work out correctly. So this is my pitch.
Okay, if that's it for student pitches, then we're going to move on to staff pitches.
Hey everyone, so I'd like to pitch an idea I've been working on as like a thought experiment or personal project. So I'm considering building a application to do distributed hosting. So the current model of the internet right now is that you have a small number of large servers. Think Facebook, Google, Amazon, and all of these control your traffic. So all your web traffic that goes through the Google search engine has to go through the Google servers. And that's a very good way if you want to restrict people from accessing the internet, or censor material, or influence people and what they can view. So this project would allow people to host their content across a number of different computers and make sure that no one node failure or no one malicious actor can take down an entire website. And this will be split up into two stages. In the first stage, we'll be implementing a way to host a website with just static content. So this is like your HTML, CSS, JavaScript, basic web development things, except split up instead of on one server among maybe two or three virtual machines. Then, if we have time, I'll show you how to implement a distributed database. So let's say you want to store some data on this web server. You can shard the data and replicate it so that it's more secure. It's safe against potential hackers or any other malicious parties. This is going to be a fairly difficult project, but I'm sure that anyone who's interested is probably skilled enough to take it on this semester.
Hi, my name is Sathvik. I'm a staff member. I like working on medical devices, so my pitch is for, how many of you guys know what strabismus is? It's a condition that you have when your eyes are both slightly off axis. So you kind of see like these pirate characters in movies where they show you that they have like one eye that's like completely off axis. Right? That seems like a major issue, but in reality, most of us have strabismus to a minor extent. So one of our eyes is either off on the vertical axis or horizontal axis. And this doesn't really affect your health in any way, but it's sometimes considered a cosmetic flaw, and people like to get this corrected. Now, at the moment, the equipment that, or the equipment and the machinery that doctors use to detect how much your eye is off axis by, is either really old and requires them to like measure with a protractor, or is like a really large piece of equipment that was created by a company like Canon or Nikon and costs about like $10,000. So the pitch that what I'm pitching is a way to do this using just like an iPhone, like just about any phone. You just look into your phone and then it'll measure which axis of which eye is off and how many degrees it's off by. This, if you're interested in this, this will give you an opportunity to learn about computer vision, image processing, and that's what it is.
Okay, do we have anybody else? Okay, so this is like last call for anybody in this room to pitch. All right, okay, so you guys are done for today. Make sure to show up on Saturday. There's gonna be really great food, so And you'll have to meet your PMs in your group, so be there.
We'll send out the link to the form sometime tonight. Be sure to fill that out, and then we'll match you with your team and let you know. Homework 2 will be out tonight.
It's already out.
All right. You heard it. Homework 2 is out.